It is a real pleasure for me to present Michael Coles. I actually just met Mr. Coles tonight, but I'm from Atlanta and I'm a big, big chocolate chip cookie person. And Michael Coles was the founder of probably the most successful company known as the Great American Cookie Company, which he seeded or started with an investment of only $8,000 and then sold it years later for millions of dollars. And so if we're looking for a successful entrepreneur, we have him tonight, a man who has gone on to be involved in numerous civic activities. He's here tonight with his lovely wife. And if you all would give him a very warm OFC welcome, Michael Coles.
Good evening.
Good evening.
All right. Can everybody hear me in the back? All right. I'm very excited to be here. I can't think of a group that I would rather have an opportunity to speak to than a group of innovative and entrepreneurs. And I love telling the story of the Cookie Company because it is an absolute example that in America all things are possible and about living the American dream. Because if you think about it, when the Great American Cookie Company started, we started the company with only $8,000. My partner and I had no experience whatsoever in the food business. Neither one of us had, both of us come out of the clothing business. There were already three major chains that were in the cookie business, and very little capital, three major competitors. If you were a shopping mall developer, which is where we wanted to open our stores, who would you have leased space to? One of the three major companies or two guys out of the clothing business with $8,000 in the bank? The answer is pretty obvious. It would have been one of the three big companies. But we were determined that we had a twist on being in the cookie business that was different than anybody else, and that if we could get that first location, we could be a success. And we struggled to get that first location, primarily because it was, what I said, with our background and very little capital. But we finally found the mall here in Atlanta, Perimeter Mall, where the mall manager, a guy named Jeff Weil, took a liking to us and gave us an opportunity to open our first store. Now you would think that when we had that opportunity, we would have made sure that we had a great business plan, which we did, and we had crossed all the T's, dotted all the I's, figured out everything we needed to do to get that store open. So I'm going to take you quickly back to the first day, just so you have some understanding of how we started. We opened that first store at Perimeter Mall, or got our lease, and we projected that we'd open the store on June 29th. And because we didn't have any money to do any television or radio, we handed out flyers around the mall and in the surrounding neighborhoods that said that from 9 o'clock in the morning until 12 noon, we would give away free cookies. We figured if people could taste our cookies, they would love them and they would come back. And so we sent out those flyers, and we didn't know if anybody would even show up on the 29th of June, but lo and behold, we got there on the 29th early in the morning to get the store ready about 7 o'clock in the morning. And about 8:30 in the morning, we got ready to put our first batch of cookies into the oven. We had a big revolving oven in the store with a window in the front of it, and people out in the mall could actually watch the cookies bake. And so we put that first batch of 300 cookies into the oven, and people out in the mall are watching the cookies bake. About 200 or 300 people showed up. At that point, we were very excited. And so they're watching the cookies go around and around. They start out like little dough balls, looking almost like ice cream scoops. And they watch them go from the kind of a creamy color to a tan color. And at the moment the bell went off, indicating that those cookies were ready to be served, those people out in the mall got really excited. We got really excited. And we walked over to the oven and we saw these magnificent golden brown chocolate chip cookies sitting on their trays in that big revolving oven at 350 degrees. And it was exactly at that moment we realized we had no pot holders. We had no way to get the cookies out of the oven. Now, of course, people in the mall have no idea what's going on. They're just watching the cookies go round and round, go from this creamy, from this golden brown color to a much darker shade of brown, to the cookies eventually catching fire on their trays. Smoke was pouring out of our oven. People were running out. We were on a combined air conditioning system with Park Lane hosiery. The mall was filling up with smoke. People were running out of Park Lane hosiery screaming. The fire department came. And I remember standing in the store, looking out into the mall, and I saw Jeff Weil, the mall manager, the guy who had taken the chance on us, walk up to the store and had one question to ask. Is this what it's going to be like every day, guys? Well, we didn't get open on the 29th. In fact, we spent the rest of that day and most of the night cleaning up a big cookie mess. But we did manage to get open the following day, and we opened with a great success. In our first 30 days of business, we needed to do $12,000 to break even. In fact, we did over $30,000. Things seemed to be going every possible way that would indicate that we would be a success. We had people from all over the country applying for franchises. We didn't have to go hat in hand any longer to shopping mall developers. They were coming to us and asking us to open up stores in their malls. Everything that you would think would be in place for us to be a success seemed to be there. Well, the second part of my story is that, just like so many of you, I always thought my greatest challenge would be to provide for my family, make sure my kids got a good education, and all those basic things of life. But life doesn't always deal the cards that you expect. 6 weeks after we started the company, I woke up in a hospital with two doctors standing over my bed telling me that I was going to live, but I had been involved in a near-fatal motorcycle accident and would probably never walk normally again. I would always need some type of aid, either canes or crutches. I figured, considering the alternative of not waking up at all, that that was okay. And so I started a rehabilitation program, but about 6 months after my accident, I had an incident with my daughter, Taryn, that changed my life forever. We were walking up our very steep driveway when she asked me to race her to the mailbox, and I took off to run and realized I couldn't do it. The pain was just excruciating. And it was the very first time since my accident that I realized that I was disabled. But not so much disabled in my legs, disabled in my mind. I come from a very poor family, and throughout my life, people had always told me what my limits were, and it always gave me the challenge to prove them wrong. But this time, I was living in a safety zone that had been given to me by doctors. When I came back into the house, I told my wife, Donna, there was no way that I would spend the rest of my life like this. I had to try to get better. And so I began a self-styled rehabilitation program that eventually took me from a stationary bike to a regular bike and started riding longer and longer distances from my house. And at the same time we built the cookie company to its national success, I not only learned to walk again, but in the process set 3 world records riding across the United States on a bicycle. From Savannah, Georgia. Thank you. From Savannah, Georgia to San Diego, California in 15 and a half days in 1982. Broke my own record in 1984, riding across the country in 11 days. And then in 1989, joined a 4-man team to do the race across America from Los Angeles to New York. We crossed the 3,000 miles in 5 days, 1 hour, 8 minutes, and I'm proud to stand here tonight to tell you that both records still stand today. If I can impress upon one thing this evening, it's this. There are always going to be people that will tell you that the time for prosperity, the prime time for opportunity, is a time from the past. My company is a living example that, again, in America, all things are possible. If you're willing to work hard, have passion about what you do, you can accomplish most things. One of the questions I'm often asked is, what do I think is the most important ingredient to success? And as I think back about giving an answer to that, I always come back to thinking about the story of David and Goliath, one of the great first stories I ever heard about overcoming adversity. If you think about that story, we all know that David, a small man, walked into the valley against this enormous giant, armed with armor and a sword and weapons. And David merely had a slingshot and a few stones. Now, we all know that David not only won that battle, but in fact slayed the giant. And you could say to yourself that the takeaway from that story is that David took the giant by surprise and was able to take him down with that slingshot and a few stones. And it would really be great in life if all of our competitors took us for granted and we were able to take them by surprise. And that would be a great moral to come away from the story. But for me, the real takeaway of the story of David and Goliath is the fact that David had the courage to step into the valley in the first place without knowing what the outcome would be. So whether it's forgetting potholders, getting into shape, going out and getting a new job, starting your own business, whatever it may be, we all face our own Goliath challenges every single day. And the real question we have to ask ourselves is whether we have the courage to step into the valley. Thank you all very, very much.